Good evening. Welcome to Love Talk. I'm Gregory Morgan. For a lot of people, we use the word love without ever even considering what does it really mean. And of course, there have been poets and philosophers and thinkers throughout time, as well as multiple dictionaries in many languages, attempting to describe what is this thing of love. And so I certainly don't hold myself out as being the one who actually has the ultimate answer about what that is. I do have educated sense of what it is to be in love and the various types of love that we experience as human beings, which are all normal expressions of our human experience. And so I want to talk about those experiences of love on this show and see if I can give you some space. By space, I mean some freedom, some ability to move about, some more choice and liberation in your life from the constraints. Sometimes those constraints can be societal or cultural. Most of those constraints that you feel, those times when you feel held back in your love life, it's usually coming from your own interpretations and beliefs about yourself. Begin to define with you some of the various types of love that we experience, like I said, as human beings. What is healthy? What is normal? And what are the things that we need to grow and overcome and develop ourselves as human beings? It takes practice and it takes learning and it takes having a coach. It takes having somebody who can guide you in that direction, help you see what it is that you needed to see, and actually help you to rise above that and create something new where that old pattern used to be. Otherwise, what will happen, what's predictable, I've seen it happen, is that you will slip back into that old way of being because it's familiar, it's comfortable, it takes less effort, even though it may be destroying your life and costing you happiness, well-being, friendship, intimacy, sex, money, all of the things that are precious to people. Even though it may be costing you all of that, you will find yourself sometimes slipping back into the same old patterns that you used to have, even though you know those patterns are destructive. So with advanced neurological repatterning, we actually destroy those old patterns so that you can't go back to them. I'll give you an example. When I say destroy, that sounds like violent or horrible or terrible, but not really. It's perfect. When you buy it, what's important in there is the milk. You don't keep of this package. No, you destroy that. You get rid of that. And it's good that you get rid of that. It's a good thing because once it's done, it's served its purpose, it should be gotten rid of. Many of the patterns that you have developed in your life around love and relationship, those patterns were appropriate at the time they were created. At the time that you were having a significant, overwhelming, painful emotional experience, you adapted the best you could at that time. And what you did, it was a good thing you did that, because then you survived emotionally, mentally, physically, spiritually. You're still here and you're watching the show, so you are interested in growing and learning. Otherwise, you wouldn't be watching this. So you're still interested in growing and learning, which means you're still interested in learning to be more of the person that you were here to be so that you can love and be loved. All of those things are still important to you. There are those for whom it's not even important anymore. They have given up, literally. They've given up. So you're not one of those. Congratulations. The significant emotional experiences that happened in your life are the traumas, the negative things that we hold on to. Those things were triggers. They were signals in order for you to learn something. They were never meant to be a pattern for the rest of your life. If you twist your ankle and it's painful to put your weight on it, you go to the doctor. They might give you a cane or something to help you walk with. In the meantime, you're not supposed to keep that cane or that crutch for the rest of your life. That would be detrimental. That would be harmful to your ankle that got injured. There's a time where it's good to protect that, and then there's a time when you have to throw the crutch away. And many of the negative patterns that you have in your life were crutches from a painful time that you're still carrying around. You're still going through that pattern as if the danger was still here, as if it was still present, as if that horrible thing that was about to happen or that did happen was going to happen again any minute. That's no way to live your life, and it renders you powerless to actually experience the full joy and completion and fulfillment and communication and belonging that is a part of loving relationships, that's a part of belonging to in a world with others in which you actually contribute to others, not try to get something from them. You know, so many people are in trying to get in relationships so that they can get something for themselves, so that they can feel better about themselves, so that they can have what they need. And so many people are looking at relationships and love like I need it, like they're trying to get some love rather than experiencing that love is a natural state of being and that there's more than enough to share. And so bringing their love to the party, bringing their happiness and their well-being to the relationship, knowing that the more you give, the more you get back. In talking about the different kinds of love, I'm really talking about what is it to be a human being. There are four distinct types of love that you will experience in your life. Two of them are unconditional. There are two types of love that are unconditional. And many people are under the illusion that love should be, or love is, unconditional. That's not true. That's not my experience, and it's not the experience of millions of other people. So here's what I see. You start off in life with unconditional love, and I'm going to say even before you're born, you are experiencing something that I would call unconditional love, in that God, the universe, nature, spiritual energy has enveloped you and brought you into this world. That in itself is an expression of natural love. But the real love, the real unconditional love, and the first one that you encounter, like consciously, is maternal love. And I'm gonna say that maternal love is pretty much unconditional. Your mother pretty much loves you unconditionally. When she loves you, it's unconditional. No matter how much bad stuff you do, she just keeps loving you, and she'll defend you until the day you die or the day she dies, because you're her kid and you came from her, and she will love you unconditionally for the rest of your life, just like God does. I don't believe God's love is conditional. I believe God's love is unconditional. And if you don't believe in God, then apply that word and use the universe. Use universal consciousness. I will have to say that for my part, I understand and personally experience a universal type of consciousness that is aware of itself. And that awareness of itself being aware, you can call that whatever you want. It knows it's here and it knows what it's doing. It's not an accident, and it is conscious of itself. If it helps people to imagine that this universal life force is a bearded man in the sky, want to call it the Great Spirit. Various peoples throughout all time have experienced this consciousness that I'm talking about and given it their own name. Don't get stuck with, if I call it God, it's just for the sake of conversation. If you don't believe in God, I challenge you to tell me how'd you get here and what's making all the stars and the planets and the plants and the animals and bugs and all that stuff work impeccably and perfectly. I don't think it's an accident. It's impossible for me to believe that that accidentally happened. So something is in that is breathing all the time, and I'm going to say that it's nature. The nature of its expression is love. So we're talking about love talk, and I believe that unconditional love, the first one that you experience is your parents, especially your mother. So I'm going to call that maternal love. Paternal love, the love of a father, I'm not so sure it's unconditional. I believe that it is. However, I think that there's things that you could do that would have your father disown you. You may be able to have your father stop, if not stop feeling love for you, stop expressing love for you. I'm going to say that maternal love is the only unconditional love that we experience as a child, and then we experience something that is called filial love or fraternal love, meaning the love of equals. That would be the love that you experience with your brothers and sisters, your playmates, people that are of your same level. So it is the love of an equal for an equal. By the way, the love of a parent for their child is the love of a superior to an inferior. And the love of a child for its parent is a love of an inferior to a superior. Well, when you're a child, your parents are definitely superior beings. They can walk, talk, eat, feed themselves, feed you. They can do all kinds of stuff, drive cars that you can't do. Therefore, I'm saying that they're a superior being, superior not in their beingness, but they're superiorly developed as a human being to an inferior. Fraternal love is a love of an equal for an equal. You're pretty much all on the same basis. Yeah, some of you can run faster and some are smarter and some are stronger, but you're on an equal level with each other in that sense. And so this fraternal love is conditional, for one thing. It is no longer unconditional love. It is conditional. Your friend can turn against you. You can turn against your friend. Your brother, it can become your enemy. It is not an unconditional love. It is a conditional love. As long as you behave and act within certain acceptable norms, your equals will continue to love you or not. It is the love of an equal for an equal. It is not conditional. And the other thing is it's not sexual. Now, I know some of you have sex with your friends. That's not a norm that most people follow. By the way, once you have sex with your friend, you are no longer on a level of equal to equal love, but platonic, meaning no sex, platonic love. So filial love is equal to equal, it's conditional, and it is platonic, meaning non-sexual. The third kind of love that you experience in your life, if you're lucky, or maybe if you're unlucky, is eros, which is erotic love. It is the love of a masculine and a feminine energy. Now, it doesn't have to be a male and a female, as we well know. It can be two males or two females, but there will always be a masculine one and a feminine one. There will always be one who is more outgoing, positive, young, penetrating in their thoughts and feelings and even sexually, and one who is more receptive and withdrawn, taking it in. So there will always be a masculine and a feminine in erotic love or in sexual love. And again, this love is not unconditional. It is conditional. And that's where most people run into problems. They think that once they have... This love is very interesting because it is sexual, it is both potentially life-giving, and we're all aware of that subconsciously when we're making love or having sex with a person of the opposite sex, subconsciously aware that we are somehow creating life. Now, whether a baby actually comes from that or not, some life was created. And by the same term, it is life-threatening. It wasn't until not very long ago, recently, that the mortality rate at birth used to be very, very high, 50%. Chance. You had a 50% chance of dying if you were a pregnant woman, either giving birth or of the child dying. It didn't always turn out well. Pregnancy was a very life-threatening situation to be in. And for that reason, women are more choosy about their sex. Women are selective in the sense that they should be selecting a man who will protect and provide her for her and her children, during a long period of time when they're quite vulnerable. When she's vulnerable, not only giving life, nurturing life, but she has this infant to provide and protect for. So women want to choose a man who not only can, but who will provide and protect for her in a gentle and kind and generous way. I want to continue to talk about this erotic love for a moment, because this love is conditional. It is not unconditional, and it is not a superior to an inferior, and nor is it an equal to an equal. People are under the illusion, and this has been brought forth in the last, I don't know, since the 70s, that men and women are equal. They are not equal. I am not equal to my wife, nor is she equal to me. There are things that I'm far better at and always will be, and I don't care. She can try her best. I'll always be the best at that if we were competing. There are things, probably more things, that she's far better at than I am, and I can never be equal to. Giving birth is one of them. A man can never do that. You could say, well, okay, a man's inferior to a woman, but then there's things that a man can do that a woman could never do. So you could say, well, a woman's inferior to a man. No, they are unequal partners. They are not equal to each other, and we mate with an unequal. And that's the beauty of it. That's the excitement of it. That's the juice of it. The masculine and the feminine coming together create life, but it's also life-threatening. Therefore, it's not unconditional. It's conditional. If certain conditions aren't met, it just doesn't work. The last kind of love that we experience, and I won't say it's the last, but I'll say the last one that I'm talking about for the moment, is called agape. And it is from a Greek word meaning divine love. It is a spiritual love, and it is the love of all humanity, and it is unconditional and platonic or non-sexual. So let me go ahead and take some calls. Hello, this is Gregory. You're live on the air with Love Talk.
Hello, Mr. Gregory. Hi. Nice to speak to you.
Thank you.
I tried to phone before and But anyway, I'm happy now.
Can Great.
You. My wife actually a little bit problem is that she's very good and everything, but the only thing has, you know, she's about doing like some like she's very fussy about cleaning the house and to everything to be clean all the time. And as we do the like neural language and then working on the nerves and as you said, we can just want to speak to you about you may be able to change this type of behavior. Like
you said, your wife is very fussy about keeping the house clean.
Yes,
there's people who just like the house clean. I mean, I like the house clean. My wife likes the house clean. But then there's people who are phobic. In other words, they're afraid to touch something because it might have germs on it, so they have to go wash their hands. The pen is laying on the table and it's a little crooked. They have to go straighten it, otherwise they just like get upset. I mean, that's a phobic.
Yes. She's not that bad, but
okay.
You know, she's looking, for example, in a normal time, you know, you may be over the house in once a day, but...
I think that we can all agree on certain behaviors as being, without having to clearly define them, I think that we can all have a general idea of what would be called normal behavior.
Yes.
If you spilt coffee on the table and somebody wiped it up, that's normal. You know, if it was a nice table and it left a mark and they got out some furniture polish and cleaned it, that would probably be normal too. But if you put your hand on the table,
I can't see any mark on the coffee table or something like that. But
if she's cleaning the house 10 times a day, there's something much deeper that's going on here. It's not about the house. It's not about clean. It's something else.
The behavior that is like,
yeah.
Bothering, you know?
Yeah, she has no freedom around that. You understand? She's compelled to do it. When I say the word compel, I mean obliged to. In other words, she doesn't have a choice. Something's driving her to do that. And it's not her conscious mind. You understand? It's coming from an unconscious place in her, a place that she doesn't know, she doesn't master, she's not aware of. And so it makes her go clean the house. She's not going, oh, I think I'll just go clean the house because I really enjoy it. This is a phobic reaction. When you are in the grips of a phobic reaction, you cannot act normally. It compels you to behave, to act out certain behaviors in spite of yourself. You know, so for some people it might be just getting on an airplane. You know, most people can walk down the little tunnel thing and get on an airplane, and you know, they might have, even if they had a little bit of fear, they could act normal. But a person with a phobia about that can't even act normal. They can't breathe, they get dizzy, all kinds of things happen to their body that they have no control over.
You want to speak to her now? She's happy to speak to you because she's just kidding and said, I'm going to speak as well. You know?
Okay, well, if she wants to speak to me, put her on the phone.
Hello, Mr. Gregory.
Hi, how are you?
Now, with my husband, have got complained about my cleaning
your
time and many things I ask him. And actually, I don't know really. It makes me, it hurts me as well.
What would you like to do? In other words, when you see something fall on the floor, let's say you take something out of the icebox and something falls on your floor that's perfectly clean, what would you like to be able to do?
On the floor, if it's clean, nothing, just walking on it and have a look at it and enjoy. See anything, for example, the hair or dust or anything, I just like to clean immediately, exactly on that time. And I don't want to leave it. If I leave it, I cannot do anything else perfect. For example, I cannot go to another job. I cannot go, for example, go out for shopping, go anything else. I cannot concentrate to anything else.
Right.
I want to do everything tidy, clean, and perfect, and because all my jobs is perfect all the time, and then going for another one.
So is this something that you would like to have more freedom around, or is this something that you feel like you have to when you speak to me? I'm not hearing that you're necessarily happy about it. Does this bring you happiness to have everything perfect all the time?
Yes, yes. If I make everything happy, clean, I'm going to be happy. But always my husband in here and do everything exactly opposite on me. And when I want, when I ask him to do everything clean. The same as my way, he do exactly the same as opposite.
Yeah, I understand. Well, that would be kind of normal. In other words, he feels constrained by that. He feels controlled. And I suggest that there's not a lot I'm going to be able to do in a few minutes with you two. You know what I mean if I say a control strategy, right?
Mm-hmm.
A control strategy. Your being all clean all the time is a way of controlling not only your environment, but it's also an attempt to control your husband. You know, if you really love someone, how it's okay for them to be the way they are. And I would say the same thing to him. If he really loves you and you want everything clean, then okay, great. Let you stop complaining that everything's so clean. And does that make sense?
Actually, I don't love him. And he knows that. It's a good question, yeah. He doesn't anything to make me happy, really. And I try to always, before, about 11 years ago, I tried to make love feeling between us, but he didn't answer me.
You know, when you say, I don't love him and he knows that, I don't know if you're actually kidding, if you're making a joke about that, or if that's just the state of your relationship.
I'm not joking. Really, it's really, I'm not loving him. I just live with him, but I don't love him, and he knows that.
Okay. And does he love you?
I think he needs me. He doesn't love me, no. He doesn't love me before, and he didn't love me as well. He just married with me because her sister, you need to marry now because we need somebody to come and care us. Because her mother leg was broken and she couldn't give the service to his sister, and that's why Kurush. Okay, he said, "What you thinking?" Anyway, I think he just married with me just for her family, and he didn't feel love me from when 11 years ago I married with him, and now, and I tried to. Really.
Okay, so I got all that. Now, so what are you going to do? You're just going to continue living together and keeping the house really, really clean? Because what's going on is of a much deeper nature. People need to love. They need to have love in their life and express it. And they need to feel love, not only for other people, but from other people. It's part of being a human being. And if we don't, if that is missing for us, then unusual behaviors will start to happen that are designed to control and manipulate and dominate and avoid domination. There will be ongoing complaints that are never resolved, and eventually it will cause mental illness, physical illness, spiritual illness, and emotional illness. In other words, dis-ease. Most of the diseases that people have, cancer and heart disease and ulcers and intestinal problems, are because people are eating and breathing and living with something that is undigestible, that they cannot stomach, and so they begin to have physical problems that are a perfect expression of those inner things that are not there. I think you cleaning every 10 times a day and him complaining about it and continuing to get the place dirty, that is a pretty good description of a living hell. And so my question to you is, why do you guys continue to participate in that? Either really start loving each other or get the heck away from each other. You, just because you've been together for 11 years doesn't mean you have to stay together for the rest of your life and make yourselves and everybody else miserable. I'm not recommending that you get a divorce. I'm actually recommending, see, I think it's not true that you don't love him. I think that you're not in touch with your love for him. I think if anything bad happened to him, that you would suffer from that.
Because he's really calm and nice man. And everybody went to see him, said, oh, you are really lucky to marry with him. But I don't feel like this. And the most important thing I live with him is my child. I've got a 7 years old girl. My daughter is mm-hmm. 7 years old at the moment. Yeah. And their relationship is really, really nice. My daughter and my husband.
Well, let me ask you something.
I always think when I divorce him, make separate them, and it's not fair for her. You know, always when I think about it, it makes me cry really. And
I got it. That is your love for her.
And my daughter really makes love to him, and I cannot never ever think make separate them.
Yeah.
I think with myself, I should stay in this relation because of my daughter.
Okay, but that's cheating your daughter too. Your daughter deserves to have parents that are happy and that love each other so that she can have an example of what that's like in her life. Do you know that the way you're raising your daughter with this no love thing going on in your life, did you know that 90% of what she's learning from you is unconscious and without words? Most of what she's learning about love and relationships and human beings, she's learning in total silence. She's learning watching and feeling and knowing inside certain all kinds of stuff. That's how you learned. That's how I learned. That's how people learn. We learn mostly from experience and observation. The words, they have about maybe 7% of what we learn is from the word, and about 30% of it is from people's actions, their physical body and their tonality, how they speak and how they move around. That's why you can learn from somebody who even speaks another language, because you kind of understand them as a human being from watching them. And then, but the rest of it is all physicality and all in the subconscious learning. Do you understand what I'm saying? You're teaching her to have a life like you have. You are teaching your daughter to have a relationship with men like you have. That's where she's going to learn how to have relationship.
Because I know if I make separate from my husband, I know that if separate my daughter, I cannot give that love she needs to her, because most of the time I don't show my love, really my love to her, because I don't have got time to do that. But my husband always, if he's at home, he spends his time for my daughter, and I'm really glad about it when I see that. Yeah. And that's why
we started this conversation with that you clean the house 10 times a day, and it bothers him, okay?
Yeah.
Yeah. Here's what I got to say to you about that, and you can ask your husband to translate. Love, right. Love is not a feeling. Love is not a feeling. You may feel love, but that's not what it is. Okay, what you feel is the reflection of love, the feelings of love. Love is an action. Love is a verb. Love is something that you do, that you give, and you do it without any expectation of return. If you're waiting to feel the feelings of love for your husband, well, okay, you already know they're not coming. But to love someone is to be for them. And you said, you know, look, if I divorced him, he'd be lonely and I would feel guilty about that. That's the part of you that's for him. You really care how he feels. You care what happens to him. That caring is love. You may not call it love. You may call it normal human decency. Okay, but that's love. It's normal to feel love and to care about another, to care about their happiness, to want them to be happy. Now, whatever happened between you guys for the last 11 years, you guys need to go into therapy and get that complete, like in the past, because it is in the past. If you're going to stay the rest of your life together, whether it's for the child or not, or because you would feel guilty, I mean, that's disgusting to stay with somebody because you would feel guilty if you left them. That's disgusting, okay? That's no way to live a life. There's no nobility in that. There's no dignity. There's no satisfaction. There's no fulfillment. There's no humanity in that. That's like the dark side of humanity. I would feel guilty, which is all about you. When you feel guilty, it's about you. It's never about the other person. It's about, I'm a bad person, so I feel bad about myself. It's all about you. Feeling guilty is a focus on one's self. It's a negative type of egotism that considers oneself so important, you ruined somebody's life, never taking into account that they got their own life that they're responsible for. My recommendation to you is to find the love, create the love, cause the love, do loving things and be loving. Give love with no expectation. Give it because you can, you know? You don't have to feel it to love. Do you think they love each other 100% of the time, all day, every day, no matter what, no matter what the other person does, no matter what's going on in their life, no matter what handsome man or woman is flirting with them? You think you always love the other person? The answer is no. Loving another human being is something that you do whether you feel like it or not. And I promise you, there's going to be days that you're not going to love your daughter, but you're going to love her anyhow because she's your daughter. You're not going to feel like love. You can do the same thing with your husband. You may not feel the love, but you could act in a loving way, give love. You know, you may find that you start to feel love, but you can't feel love unless you give love. You have to give it first. You got to give it, whether you feel it or not. And then the feelings start to come.
To want to give him really love, because he makes me always angry. And when I get angry of him, I cannot give the love to him.
That's something you need to work on, okay? Mm-hmm. My wife makes me angry, and I give her love anyhow.
Actually,
okay, it's a practice. It's an adult practice. That's what adults do. Adults don't wait around for the feelings. Adults take action. It's an adult thing to do. In other words, I don't always feel love. I have two little puppies, right? I don't always feel love for them, but I show them love and I act loving with them whether I feel it or not. My wife is a very lovable woman. I don't always feel it. Sometimes she makes me mad, but I act as lovingly as I possibly can in spite of my negative feelings, and I know that once I do that, then I begin to feel the feelings of love. Maybe it's a day later, or maybe it's 5 minutes later. I don't know. You can't feel love if you don't act loving. I know that it's so simple that people make it difficult and complicated. You think you have to feel love before you can act loving, and it's the opposite. You have to act loving, and then maybe you'll feel love or maybe you won't. But if you act loving, at least you open the door to feeling love. But as long as the door is closed, you will neither feel it nor act it. And you're going to teach your daughter to act the same way.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Does my husband need to do exactly the same as this feeling and reacting, or all the men, because all the men is different of the woman, and I don't know.
No, of course, whatever I'm saying to both of you. What I'm saying to you, I'm saying to him as well. You know, start acting loving. You don't even know if you're going to live past tonight. Okay, none of us do. Let's quit playing like, oh, well, you know, I've got the rest of my life to be a jerk. You don't know how long you're going to live, and you don't know. And if you died tomorrow, what could we say about you and your marriage? And did you express love in your life? Did you have love in your life? Did you show others how to be a loving, kind, sweet, sexy, lovable, adorable woman? You know, the things that you're learning in the workshop. It's a practice. You don't just like go take a workshop and now all of a sudden you feel love. No, you have to practice it. I can't just go take a martial arts class and now I'm Bruce Lee.
Yeah.
You have to practice. And practice means you practice whether you feel like it or not. If you want to be a master piano player, it means you play the piano even when you don't want to. You do it every day. And then you become a master. And if you want to learn how to love and be loved, You do it every day, even when you don't feel like it. Even if it lasts for a month or a year, you keep loving until you master that.
My husband said, I'm going to go to stop the clean the house after that, do you think?
I think cleaning the house is the least of your problems. It's kind of strange, and you're doing something. It's a control strategy. It's something you're doing to control your husband, to punish him, to make him feel uncomfortable, to let him know. It's an expression of how uncomfortable you are. You know, the house being dirty, it's about you being uncomfortable with yourself. You're the one that feels dirty inside. You're the one that doesn't feel like you can go on unless everything's all perfect and clean. You know, you can't go to the store if there's a hair on the floor. You know, you're using the clean house as an excuse to not get on with your life. You're using that. That's just something you do to keep from having to confront that you have failed in your marriage, and you're failing as a mother, and you're failing as a wife. And you need to confront that and deal with it. And listen, you can suffer about that and feel guilty about it, or clean the house, make a lot of money, or make your husband mad, or you could, and this is my suggestion, please, you could do something nice for him. You could say nice things. You could act loving. You could hold hands. You could do things that would be more difficult for you, perhaps, than cleaning the house, but that would actually make a difference and change things. Cleaning the house, it doesn't change anything, does it? You can keep that house so clean, and it will never change anything for you. I love my wife. And I am a man that I like who I am as a man. And it has nothing to do whether she could start hating me and I would still love her. And I would still be okay with myself as well. She could,
she could
totally leave me. I wouldn't like it. I'd be very sad. But it wouldn't change who I am. I'm not going to change myself.
Lovely. Thank you very much, Dr. Morgan.
All right. Thank you. Bye-bye. This has been Love Talk, and we've talked about the four different kinds of love, that love is a verb or an action that you take, whether you have the feelings of love or not. And by taking these actions and moving forward, you open the doors, you open your heart, and you open the heart of other people so that you can begin to experience the affinity, the shared reality, the communication, and the knowing of each other that we call love. I'll see you back here next week on Love Talk.
قدم به قدم از آشنایی تا عشقی ماندگار توسط خانم دکتر آزیتا سایان. هر کجای رابطه که هستی، پیش از شروع، ابتدای راه، قبل از ازدواج و یا مزدوج و بچه دار، با شرکت در این سمینار خارق‌العاده عشقی ماندگار در زندگی خود خلق کنید.
اگه واقعا بخواید که فکر بکنید که من مرحله به مرحله چجوری با یک کسی آشنا بشم و چجوری رابطه رو تشکیل بدم که تبدیل بشه به یه عشقی که ماندگار باشه توی زندگی من، حتما بهتون توصیه میکنم اونایتون که واقعا براتون مهمه یاد بگیرید این مراحل آشنایی تا نگه داشتن یه رابطه. حالا همه میگن خب من نمیخوام ازدواج کنم، منم اصراری ندارم کسی میخواد ازدواج کنه، نکنیم، ولی لااقل یاد بگیریم یه رابطه سالم رو بتونیم نگهش داریم.
ونکوور شنبه 8 فوریه ساعت 7:30 عصر. بلیط های خود را همین الان از وبسایت و یا اپلیکیشن Embrace Grow تهیه بفرمایید و یا با شماره 310-462-2600 تماس بگیرید.
A haven for the weary soul. A source of inspiration and community. Redesigned to bring you meaningful experiences and unforgettable events. We are a worldwide community of vibrant individuals displayed in the people who are a part of it, from many nations, backgrounds, and beliefs. Through powerful outreach programs, the struggles of everyday life are confronted and conquered, transforming those who participate into the best versions of themselves. One-on-one sessions are available to keep you headed in the right direction, coupled with the best resources to remind you how to live, whether at home or elsewhere. Programs designed for men, providing the building blocks of maturity, commitment, integrity, and leadership, paving the way for productive and fulfilling manhood. Beyond an understanding of masculine leadership is its application in daily life and development into something truly unique. Exclusive training for women, encouraging growth and empowerment through an acceptance of their true identities, redefining interactions, and changing the viewpoint through which life is seen. Embracing the woman within and accessing facets of your personality hidden beneath the surface. Showing our youth the value of integrity and reliability by creating an indwelling desire to succeed with honor. Basing the future on a solid foundation of ideals that will guide them through life. Leading by example and showing others how to clearly convey their thoughts in a compelling way. Creating a culture of mature leaders who can help others achieve self-confidence and their goals. Real people and real lives are changed for the better. With every event, more are touched and come to an understanding of their place in this world and their community. Embrace Growth is run by a passionate team and led by the diligence and inspiration of Dr. Azita Sayan and Mr. Gregory Morgan, who consistently teach life lessons based on what works rather than the passing fads of the times. Embrace Growth has a new home online where you can easily register for workshops and events, order from the online store, and be part of the worldwide community of Embrace Growth graduates. You'll be able to see Dr. Azita Sayan and Mr. Gregory Morgan in your favorite seminars. Visit us today at embracegrowth.com.
در کارگاه‌های آموزشی بانوان به رهبری دکتر آزیتا سایان، خود واقعیتان و همچنین مردان را بشناسید و با استفاده از قدرت زنانه خود روابطی سالم و عاشقانه بسازید. هامبورگ 28 فوریه تا اول مارچ، لس آنجلس 17 تا 19 آپریل، تورنتو 26 تا 28 جون و ایروان ارمنستان 6 تا 8 آگوست برگزار خواهد شد. 310-462-600 embracegrowth.com. قدم به قدم از آشنایی تا عشقی ماندگار توسط خانم دکتر آزیتا سایان. هر کجای رابطه که هستی، پیش از شروع، ابتدای راه، قبل از ازدواج و یا مزدوج و بچه دار، با شرکت در این سمینار خارق‌العاده عشقی ماندگار در زندگی خود خلق کنید.
این سمینار بسیار سمیناریه که توش چیز یاد میگیرین، یعنی اصلا تکون دهنده است، مثل یه ورکشاپ میمونه. یعنی همه حتی فارغ التحصیل ما تو سمینار بودن گفتن این سمینار خودش مثل یه ورکشاپ مینی قیمت 25 دلاریه و واقعا میخوام بهتون بگم به اندازه 300-400 دلار برداشت میکنی از یه سمینار چند ساعته. حتما بیاین ما رو ببینید.
ونکوور شنبه 8 فوریه ساعت 7:30 عصر. بلیط های خود را همین الان از وبسایت و یا اپلیکیشن Embrace Grow تهیه بفرمایید و یا با شماره 310-462-600 تماس بگیرید. یک مرد منحصر به فرد، مسلط، متمرکز، قابل اعتماد و رضایتمند باشید. کارگاه شرافت، عزت کلام و مهارت به رهبری دکتر آزیتا سایان. لس آنجلس 13 تا 15 مارچ، تورنتو 16 تا 18 اکتبر و ایروان ارمنستان 5 تا 7 نوامبر. برای اطلاعات بیشتر با شماره 310-462-600 تماس بگیرید. اپلیکیشن Embrace Grow. با ساختن اکانت شخصی شما می توانید وارد پروفایل خود شده و تنظیمات آن را تغییر دهید. به تمامی رویدادها و محصولات دسترسی داشته باشید. با چند کلیک برای سمینارها و کارگاه‌ها ثبت نام کنید و یا وقت مشاوره خود را رزرو نمایید. اپلیکیشن Embrace Growth را امروز از اپ استور دانلود کنید و به خانواده جهانی Embrace Growth بپیوندید. قدم به قدم از آشنایی تا عشقی ماندگار توسط خانم دکتر آزیتا سایان. هر کجای رابطه که هستی، پیش از شروع، ابتدای راه، قبل از ازدواج و یا مزدوج و بچه دار، با شرکت در این سمینار خارق‌العاده عشقی ماندگار در زندگی خود خلق کنی.
اگر ازدواج کردید و رابطه اونجوری که دلتون میخواد گرم و صمیمی و پر از عشق نیست، اگر در قسمتی از رابطتون هستین که فکر میکنین میخواید اقدام به جدایی بکنید، نکنید. بیاین این سمینار، بعدن چیزایی رو که تو این سمینار میشنوید برید و در رابطتون پیاده بکنید، بعدن تصمیم جدی بگیرید. در هر مقطعی که هستید واقعا بهتون توصیه میکنم که این سمینار خاص رو از دست ندید. به جرئت میتونم بگم بهترین سمیناریه که خودم تا حالا روش کار کردم.
با این سمینار متفاوت مخصوص مجردین و متأهلین دوباره عاشق شوید. ونکوور شنبه 8 فوریه ساعت 7:30 عصر. بلیط های خود را همین الان از وبسایت و یا اپلیکیشن Embrace Grow تهیه بفرمایید و یا با شماره 310-462-2600 تماس بگیرید.